Chris Morell says, "Hey, Chris, we've consulted before about my homozygous H63D. I've noticed over the years, H63D, by the way, for those of you who are not familiar, is one of the genes that predisposes to hemochromatosis, a condition of iron overload, and it is the weaker form of hemochromatosis. Most clinicians who work in this area do not consider the H63 allele to be a concern because it's less severe, but most people who are progressive on the iron research front do believe it's a concern. There is literature showing that people can get clinical hemochromatosis from it, and you don't have to get clinical hemochromatosis to be worried about iron overload. Chris and I are both, Chris, and we are also both H63D homozygous, meaning that we both have this moderately defective gene in iron regulation from both of our parents. Chris goes on, I've noticed over the course of the years, if I donate blood, my ferritin gets very low, around 30. But my snapshots of iron and transferrin saturation can be anywhere between 30 and 55%. I finally saw a hematologist who basically said I should stop donating blood. He only concerns himself with ferritin because that's the data they use. He doesn't care about iron saturation. I asked him about risk of oxidizing cholesterol, but he's not versed on that. For people like me, do you still think getting that iron saturation range is important?" Yeah, so look, my opinion on this is going to be different than someone who is an expert clinician but is not immersing themselves deeply in the physiological literature about how this works. And so, you know, I don't have the skills that they have in triaging and filtering who's ideal for what treatment and looking at large numbers of people that do one or another treatment and knowing intuitively what happens in those. But what I do have is I have immersed myself very deeply in the physiology. And so the way that I look at this is as follows. Iron saturation is an estimate of your transferrin saturation. It's a cheaper way to estimate it than to actually measure transferrin saturation. So it's much more common to get iron saturation. But let's assume that we're talking about actual transferrin saturation or that iron saturation is a good metric of it. That's your short-term iron storage. Ferritin is your long-term iron storage. The defect in the H63D allele, same for the C282Y allele of the HFE gene, the two moderate and severe hemochromatosis alleles. An allele is a type of, is a variant of a gene. So the problem with those two variants is that actually I should have explained this first. In normal physiology, what happens is transferrin acts as a gauge of your iron status. And the normal physiological levels are between 30 and 40%. Now being 41% doesn't mean you have a disease. We're not talking about diagnosis here. We're talking about understanding the physiology. Mechanistically, this is designed so that as you go from 30 to 40%, and especially as you go over 40%, that communicates the signal to a hormonal system that says you have more iron than you need. So you ramp down iron absorption and you ramp up ferritin. Why do you ramp up ferritin? Because you have more than you need in your short-term storage, so that's when you put it into your long-term storage. Also because ferritin is a protective response that prevents you from having free iron. Free iron is bad because it feeds pathogens and it makes infections worse. Free iron is bad because it causes oxidative stress and causes wear and damage on your tissues. And so to avoid free iron, you ramp up ferritin while you take down your absorption from food at the same time. What's wrong in H63D and in C282Y alleles of the HFE gene that Chris and I have is that that communication system is somewhat impaired. And so what happens is that transferrin saturation goes up higher than it should be without kicking ferritin in. And this is a little bit counterintuitive because people are used to thinking of ferritin as the marker of the disease state. And so in their mind, you have the advanced disease state. You have the person who needs an artificial pacemaker. You have the person who needs a liver transplant in mind. And you think ferritin is 1,000. So high ferritin is the mark of a problem. But that's because we're not looking at what happens 30 or 40 years before the person needed an organ transplant. 30 or 40 years before the person needed an organ transplant was the transferrin saturation went up And instead of ramping down intestinal iron absorption, you kept absorbing it from your food. Instead of ramping up ferritin, you let ferritin hang low. And so the transferrin saturation going up higher than you would expect it to go, and the ferritin being lower than you would expect it to be, is the sign of the earliest physiological event that leads 30 or 40 years down the road to hemochromatosis. So I don't look at this as diagnosis because I'm not a healthcare practitioner. I'm not treating Chris's iron issue. I'm not diagnosing anything. I'm looking at this from the perspective of what is physiologically happening. And so what I see when the transferrin saturation is high and the ferritin is going down, that sounds like exactly what you would expect in the very earliest cases of iron overload. And now, is that a problem at all? You could debate that. But if you're just talking, if you're not talking about diagnosis and you're talking about wellness and you're talking about health management, then I don't know where Chris's question disappeared from my screen. I don't know. When you're looking at it from the perspective of wellness, then to me, what I would want to do myself in that situation is I would, first of all, not let the ferritin go under 20. And if it's going near there, I would be getting a CBC to make sure I'm not making myself anemic, right? The worst case scenario is to become anemic. And you definitely should stop donating blood if you're anywhere near anemia. But if you are not anywhere near anemia, then you probably want the ferritin to be lower than you want it in almost anyone else, because you might have iron that you need to deload from your tissues. And so I would not stop donating blood just because the ferritin is going down 60, 50, 40. I would consider it a gray area. It would be my preference to focus on the transferrin saturation and get it consistently under 40%. But I would not do that if it meant going anemic. I would not do that if it meant feeling like crap. But if I do that and I'm not anemic and I feel good or better, then I will absolutely keep doing that. And of course, if you're donating blood, then there are precautionary measures built in to make sure that you don't go anemic. Like you get the pinprick to look at your serum iron levels. They're not going to let you donate blood if you're actually in the danger zone of anemia. So I would get the CBC to be proactive about it, but you know, if, and I would not go totally unsupervised and start leaching my own blood. But yeah, if I get let in for the blood donation and I pass their screening process and I feel better after it and there's no signs of anemia, then I think with that background, it's still a green light for blood donation.